Well, good morning and welcome to the Rock United Methodist Church this morning. We're so glad that you're here, and if you're joining us via the internet, we're happy to see you too. What a beautiful Sunday morning it is. Let's pray together. Blessed Lord, we come to you in humble adoration. Your power and your purpose, they lead our faith. Lord, give us wisdom, patience, tolerance, and the strength of your spirit. We're going through some troubled times right now. Lift up those, Lord, who suffer the most. We pray silently with those who need it so bad. Lord, let us hear and share your word. Let the Holy Spirit be present with us and all your children today. Guide us in our Christian lives, putting you and your will first. And we pray these things in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Please stand for the call to worship and remain standing for the offertory prayer.
And the call of worship is going to come from Psalms 62, 5 through 8. Yes, my soul finds rest in God. My hope comes from him.
Truly, he is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress. I will not be shaken.
My salvation and my honor depend on God. He is my mighty rock, my refuge.
Trust in him at all times, you people. Pour out your hearts to him, for God is our refuge. Amen.
Amen.
Would you bow your heads once more with me? Blessed Father, we take this time to gather and to share those treasures that you have given us so abundantly. We pray, Lord, that you would instill generosity in all of us. Bless us, guide us, and provide for us. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please pass the peace. Don't forget our change over here, you guys. For our
change over there is looking pretty good. It's getting better. We were sure. Peace be with you, sister. Can't peace be with you, brother. Peace be with you. Peace be with you, Dennis. Yeah, it's camouflaged. Peace be with you, Peggy. Peace be with you, Sarah.
Good morning, men's ministry prayer. We pray for your light in our lives. Help us see each day in the beauty you have created. Help us live boldly, preparing ourselves with family and the knowledge of our salvation. Let us serve others with gifts and abilities. Let us find teaching and ministry of Jesus on our lips among families and friends. Be with us as we turn our hearts and souls over to you. You are the path of to righteousness we seek. In Jesus' holy name, amen. Please stand and sing Crown Him.
Throne, Our first Bible reading this morning comes from Isaiah 49, verses 22 to 25. This is what the Sovereign Lord says. See, I will beckon to the nations. I will lift up my banner to the peoples. They will bring your sons in their arms and carry your daughters on their hips. Kings will be your foster fathers and their queens your nursing mothers. They will bow down before you with their faces to the ground. They will lick the dust at your feet. Then you will know that I am the Lord. Those who hope in me will not be disappointed. Can plunder be taken from warriors or captives be rescued from the fierce? But this is what the Lord says. Yes, captives will be taken from warriors and plunder retrieved from the fierce. I will contend with those who contend with you, and your children I will save. This is the word of the Lord.
The second reading is from 2 Corinthians 4, 1 through 6. Therefore, since through God's mercy we have this ministry, we do not lose heart. Rather, we have renounced secret and shameful ways. We do not use deception, nor do we distort the word of the God. On the contrary, by setting forth the truth plainly, we commend ourselves to everyone's conscience in the sight of God. And even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. The God of this age has blinded the minds of unbelievers so that they cannot see the light of the gospel that displays the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For what we preach is not ourselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord, and ourselves as your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," made his light shine in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of God's glory displayed in the face of Christ. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand and sing "Stand Up for Jesus."
Soldiers of the cross, lift high his roar. Stand up for Jesus, the strife will not be long. This day the noise of battle, the next the victor's song. To him that overcometh, a crown of life shall be. To him the King of glory shall reign eternally. To him that overcometh, a crown of life shall be. He with the King of glory shall reign eternally.
A reading from 1 Corinthians chapter 1, 3 through 9. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I always thank my God for you because of his grace given you in Christ Jesus. For in him you have been enriched in every way, with all kinds of speech and with all knowledge. God thus confirming our testimony about Christ among you. Therefore, you do not lack any spiritual gift as you eagerly wait for our Lord Jesus Christ to be revealed. He will also keep you firm to the end, so that you will be blameless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful, who has called you into fellowship with his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the gospel.
Today's gospel reading is from the book of Matthew, chapter 7, verses 7 through 14. Ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives. The one who seeks finds. And the one who knocks, the door will be open. Which of you, if your son asks for bread, will give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, we'll give him a snake. If you then, thou, you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give goods to those who ask him? So in everything, do to others what you would have them do to you, for this sums up the law and the prophets. Enter through the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the road that leads to destruction, and many enter through it. But small is the gate, and narrow the road that leads to life, and only a few find it. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated, and the children may join Michelle.
They got the words up here. Y'all can sing along with me. This isn't a solo. Y'all join in if you know the words or if you want to praise God with me.
Why you ever chose me has always been a mystery. All my life I've been told I belong at the end of the line with all the other not quite. All the never get it right. But it turns out they're the ones you were looking for all this time. So I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. Ever since you rescued me, gave my heart a song to sing. I'm living for the world to see. Nobody but Jesus, living for the world to see. Nobody but Jesus. Moses had stage fright, David brought a rock to a sword fight. You picked 12 outsiders nobody would have chosen, and you changed the world. The moral of the story is everybody's got a purpose. So when I hear that devil start talking to me, saying, who do you think? you are. Say, I'm just a nobody, trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. Ever since you rescued me, gave my heart a song to sing. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. Living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. So let me go down, down, down in history as another blood-bought, faithful member of a family. And if they all forget my name, well, that's fine with me. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. So let me go down, down, down in history as another blood-bought, faithful member of this family. And if they all forget my name, well, that's fine with me. For the world to see, nobody but Jesus. I'm just a nobody, trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. Ever since you rescued me, gave my heart a song to sing. Living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. Living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. Living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. Hallelujah. Hey. Praise God.
That's a hard song to sing. Nice key change. Really pretty. So today, I want to talk to you more than preach. Kind of want you guys to listen to what I'm saying. And I have several stories that I want to tell about what we're talking about today. In 1933, that's a long time ago, a fellow named Dietrich Bonhoeffer was a Lutheran pastor. He's really kind of a remarkable guy. He saw the changes coming in Europe, and he had been very, very forward ecumenically. He tried to include all of the churches in whatever that he did. Well, you know, if you know anything about history, 1933 is around the time that Hitler came to power. And Dietrich Bonhoeffer was against the Nazi regime. He began to work with the resistance there. Some of his friends got him to Europe because they thought he would probably be killed. He stayed there for a very short period of time, but had to go back. He said, I can't leave my people. So he very quickly was told that he could no longer speak publicly. He could no longer be a member of the regular society. In fact, they didn't even want him preaching at all. So then they said that he couldn't, not only could he not preach, but he could not publish. But he continued to work with the oppression. Some Americans got him out to New York. And before we got into the war, as Americans, he got on the very last passenger boat back to Germany, where he got off, and very soon thereafter, he was arrested. And originally, they put him in a place called Tegel Prison near Berlin. And then they sent him to a concentration camp. Very soon, before all of Germany was defeated and the people that were held in the concentration camps let go, they, without a trial, they hung this brave Christian who had held Germany together. What the strength of what he did in sharing Christ with all the others in this ecumenical, which means all the churches getting together, what that means is that when they became a country that was going to be rebuilt and the Nazis were gone, they had a foundation of Jesus Christ there, and they were able to make this industrial powerhouse that we know Germany to be. I'll tell you another story. Really kind of curious about what you think about it. What would you do to save a life? Have you ever saved a life? Have you ever been out there and had to be put in that situation? If you were alone in a vehicle on a highway and you saw an accident, would you stop? Most of us would. Now, you may feel unprepared, but most of us would do what we could do to help someone. Perhaps not. You may feel so unprepared, or this may be so shocking to you that it might not be something that you could do. But what if you noticed that the car was beginning to burn, and someone was struggling to get out? Would you help? Most of the world would help. They tried to do something. Let me add it, make it a little more tense for you. There's children in the car. What are you going to do? Are you going to just stand by and watch them? Does that change your motivation a little bit? Is there more immediacy in your mind when here is a car full of kids and adults and they're trapped and the car is burning? What would you do? How would you help? Okay. So you stop and there's one man in the car, but he can't get out. His foot is captured, it's trapped inside twisted metal. The only way to get him out is going to be to pull as hard as you possibly can. Pulling on the leg, though, causes him terrific pain. It makes it very, very difficult for you as he screams every time. But leaving him in the car will surely mean his own death. Now what do you do? How do you help? What choice do you make? A mentor of mine who practices medicine right here in San Antonio did something very, very brave. During Operation Urgent Fury, which was the assault on the prison and on, to retrieve the students in Grenada, the 82nd Airborne and most of the Rangers jumped in on the airstrip, and then they brought in some helicopters. They got on the helicopters, and they air-mobiled to the places where they needed to be. The Cubans had set up a perimeter around, so they machine gunned a lot of the people as they came down. There were numerous injuries there at the airfield, and one of the helicopters came down. This is a Black Hawk. This was actually a Huey. We still had a lot of Hueys back then. This Huey was shot down. Most of the men got out. One of the men that had been in it was trapped under part of the wreckage, and it was on fire. Steve, seeing this unconscious man there who had the side of the helicopter laying on his leg, decided that he needed to do something to help him out. So he and several others got up and they ran to this thing that was on fire and they tried to push it off of him, but no matter what they could do, they couldn't push it off. And the guy was trapped there. Steve did the only thing he could possibly do, which was the very most extreme thing. He amputated the soldier's leg on the spot. Both the soldier and Steve survived, although both of them had pretty severe wounds and burns that they had to overcome. Friends, life is precious. Life is precious. Most of us would do nearly anything to save a life. Other people are important to us, especially our families, our friends, our church families. We would try to do something. One of my patients told me this story. He lives out in the country, not too far from here. He heard a child scream. His daughter ran in and told him that there was one of the boys that she was playing with had fallen out of the tree most of the way and had actually got his arm captured up in the crook of the tree and where the tree makes a Y. He was doing what kids do. He was climbing a tree and he fell. The arm seemed to be broken or maybe the elbow dislocated. He wasn't sure at the time. But the child was pinned in the tree about 6 feet up. The kid was pale, he was having difficulty breathing. He could see that the hand was looking like it was draining of blood. He called 911, and they said that they couldn't do anything for him. It would take about 30 minutes to get anybody because there had been a big traffic accident out here on I-10. So this patient of mine had a ladder, he had a rope. He was a senior, but he thought, you know, I can certainly do something. So he put the ladder up against the tree, he climbed up it, and with some help, was able to push the boy up, which dislodged the arm, and then they both fell from the tree to the ground. He hadn't had any idea that he could have the strength to save this child, but he decided to try anyway. The boy had begged him to stop at one point because every time he moved his arm, it was awful, and his daughter was hysterical. You may have been in a situation like this before where everything seems to be going wrong. But life is important. It's valuable. It's precious. The short time that we're here on God's green earth is filled with many challenges and choices. I know this. This is the life that many of us have led. We try to protect the people that we love, don't we? We do every time, everywhere we go, we think about our fans, our friends and our family and what we can do to make things better, even if it's subconsciously. A friend of mine was at the Dairy Queen with near a strip mall. And they were there, and they had just finished. He had his wife and his daughter with him, and they had just finished eating their ice cream and were heading out. And as they opened the door, my friend heard gunshots. He automatically pushed his daughter back into the room. And his wife, who had taken a step ahead of him, he grabbed her back collar, dragged her back into the Dairy Queen. They didn't even know what was happening. Without thinking, he did this, you know, just by sheer emotional reaction, unconscious reaction, he knew that he had to place himself between them and a bullet. He scared them both with the aggressiveness that he had used. He watched the gunman run down the rest of the strip mall, firing at this one gentleman, and then the two of them disappeared. Nobody ever saw them again. Everyone in the Dairy Queen was okay. We just instinctually help others when we can. We put ourselves at risk to help others. You know, we have people among us that do that naturally. Police, firefighters, paramedics, service members. If you're a veteran, you've put your life on the line. They're always first on the scene. Our lives here on earth are important to us, no doubt. Most, if not all of us, would sacrifice ourselves to protect the physical lives of the people around us. It's what we do. Protecting physical lives of our loved ones is instilled absolutely naturally. It's an instinct that God has given us. We'll always try and protect the ones that we love. We will always try. We would sacrifice nearly everything. But here's the big question. Would we really? How about our spiritual lives? What do we do to save the spiritual lives of the ones that we love? If you have an unsaved son, daughter, or loved one you've been praying for, you're bearing a heavy burden. Boy, it's hard to save that one that just won't come to church, just won't engage in this, just won't be baptized. Pick a won't, and they won't. If you're a parent, you understand this concern. You've worried when they come home late. You worry if they don't call. You've been concerned about their decisions. Some of the things that drive you crazy are the access to drugs, alcohol, and violence. Have you prayed for their salvation? I know you've worried about their salvation. Do you pray with them? One of the greatest and most reassuring verses in Scripture is about unsaved children. And it's back to Isaiah again, Isaiah 49. It says, "Who can snatch the prey from the hands of a mighty man? Who can demand that a tyrant let his captive go?" The Lord says, "Even the captives of the most mighty and most terrible shall all be freed. For I will fight those who fight you, and I will save your children." Preparing ourselves and our loved ones for an eternity with God is an essential thing. Fathers, mothers, older brothers and older sisters, if you don't prepare your children for salvation, they are not going to be saved. If you don't engage with them, if you allow them to tell you what they're going to do over what God has told you to do, their salvation is at risk. Billy Graham said that prayer was our major tool. The Apostle John says it's having proof in our testimony about the eternal work of Christ, the internal witness of the Spirit, and the external word of Scripture. You know, eventually all of us is going to have to stand accountable for our lives. We are. Can you imagine having to stand up in front of God? Perhaps the apostles, perhaps the Jewish elders, and watch a movie about the low points of your life. Can you imagine all of those things being reflected? I'd hate to relive all the stupid, sinful things that I did as a young person. By the grace of God and our Father in heaven, That is not necessary. As we have repented, we're forgiven, and when we're forgiven, we're found righteous. Do you stand to protect your children, spouse, friends, and family the same way? Are you praying for them? Are you doing something about their salvation? How much more important is our spiritual life than our physical lives? I mean, how important is eternity? Is this where we want to be? Or do we want to be in heaven? You know, forever is a long, long time. And our relationship with God in heaven is forever. I guess I'm asking you, are you leaving someone behind because you chose not to help save them? Spiritual life is harder to protect because you can't see it. But we can feel it, can't we? Everyone is here because they know that they have a spiritual life. When someone needs our encouragement or maybe needs our support, when someone is in danger or in pain, we're expected to affect their lives in a natural, positive way, aren't we? That's what we do as Christians. Who are we supposed to do this to? Our brothers and sisters. Who are our brothers and sisters? Who does God say our brothers and sisters are? Everyone. Everyone. That's our spiritual commitment. You know, several of us have been public servants. We have teachers, administrators. Some people have worked in the service industry. Others have worked in the practice of medicine. Many, many of you have volunteered to help the poor. You serve this physical world selflessly, and that kind of work is spiritual. But we can't rest on what we have done. It's what we're going to do. Becoming a mature Christian means that we're committing ourselves to the Word of God and to that spiritual world. And to commit spiritually, we have to think about what kind of things we're doing. First of all, what would Jesus do? Well, Jesus would reason out problems as he is his Lord. We can reason out things biblically. We need to maintain a scriptural point of view. Sometimes it's difficult. Boy, they make it hard out there for us to think of everything scripturally, don't they? In the physical world, we protect our families with strong homes and with encouragement, immunizations, nutrition, education. We put all these things, physical and emotional, into effect. How do we protect them in the spiritual world? Well, we protect our faith when things get hard. Some folks fall to the temptations of life. Some fall to false prophets. There's all kinds of people out there. You can turn on the TV pretty much any time of the day and find an evangelist that really isn't there for saving your soul. They're there for making money and creating wealth. You know, if people are sinking in this overwhelming mess of our society, and we need to know where those people are, and we need to know how to throw them a spiritual life preserver. Philippians 1:6 says, "He who began a good work in you will see it through to completion." That's amazing. 1 Corinthians says, "God will sustain us to the end, guiltless in the days of our Lord Jesus Christ." And 1 John, the Apostle John told us, "If anyone obeys his word, love for God is truly made complete in them." God is with us when we're working in the spiritual. How do we know that we're saved? How do we know that others are saved? Because we live in obedience. How do our children become saved if they don't know God's word? How do our children get saved if they don't know God's word? How do our children get saved if they don't know God's word? They can't. By refusing to engage with them, we may be condemning them, or at least be complicit in their condemnation. By not reading them scripture, we're complicit in their failure. We really shouldn't take the salvation of those who are around us lightly. We have to be examples of Christianity in our homes. Moms and dads, you're the spiritual leaders of the house. We need to be the examples of Christianity everywhere we go, but especially in our home. If you're a follower of Christ, you should reflect that in your children. In the same way that you're a reflection of Jesus, your children are a reflection of you. Make sure when they're out in the world that they're behaving in a way that would make God happy. As a Christian parent, be responsible to ensure that your children are brought up in the faith. This means teaching them about Jesus and instilling Christian values in them from a young age. I know some people sitting here feel that they may not be prepared to do that. There's all kinds of children's Christian literature and actually magazines that they can get every month that where they can color in it and they can read stories about Jesus. Help them watch some of the TV shows. Having watched The Chosen several times now, this is a great, great advantage to most of us. It's important to provide them with a solid foundation where they can build their lives. One of the best ways of doing that is setting a good example yourself. Show your kids what it means to be a follower of Christ. Lead by example in everything that you do, from how you treat others to the way that you handle stress. Let them see Christ working in you. It's your job to raise godly children and godly grandchildren. Children who are disciplined and well-behaved, respect their elders, and follow what the Bible says are going to go a long way in life. If your children are lost, you do not want to be one to blame. Use your Bible and learn how to raise them according to God's standards. Claim your faith. Lead your family to salvation. Prepare every day and pray. And as we're told, God will sustain us. You have his promise. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. We're going to do communion now. Remember, in communion in the Methodist Church, everyone's invited. Everyone. So I would hope that you would join in with us.